Good evening and welcome to the first Wyndham World Affairs program of the new year. And we're extremely privileged and fortunate this evening to have Alan Gilbert, the director of ACLU for the state, to come talk to us. And when I told Emily, my wife, who I invited to join us for dinner tonight, I said, I've got a ton of questions for Alan. She said, please don't come across as some paranoid nut. You know. So I went easy on him at dinner time. But who, you know, as what was it, John Kerry said, whom among us, you know, hasn't noticed, you know, the elevated observation and intrusion and tracking of the way we live, and isn't concerned about it. And Vermont is by no means immune from that, and Alan's going to talk to us a little bit this evening about life in this new age of monitoring and surveillance. He'll have a few sort of AV things to show, and it's going to be on this small screen, so please, you know, pack in as he does that. And I can't do better in introducing Alan than read the publicity that our publicist put out. Alan Gilbert has been executive director of the ACLU of Vermont since 2004. Before that, he worked in journalism as a reporter and then city editor of the Rutland Herald and as assistant editor of the Sunday Herald Times Argus. He taught writing at several Vermont colleges and lived abroad for 3 years, teaching American studies at a German university. For 14 years, he was principal in Prescott of Montpelier, a communications and public policy research firm. Alan has also been a commentator on Vermont Public Radio. He holds a bachelor's degree in history from Harvard and a master's degree in education from the College of William and Mary. And please welcome him and look forward to a good evening.
So I figured the only way I can compete with the piano upstairs is to show you a video.
We used to be a state where promotion and the reality of privacy were true. But over the last dozen years, Vermont has been transformed into a state where we're being watched. When you use your cell phone, tracking data is sent so your cell provider knows where you are. The government can get that data. Police use automated license plate readers to track cars. Up to 1,800 plates can be captured in an hour. That's 14,400 plates during one officer's 8-hour shift. Police save the data. It shows where you've been. The Border Patrol intermittently runs traffic stops on I-91 at White River Junction, nearly 100 miles from the Canadian border. Officers want to know who you are. Are you a U.S. citizen? Facial recognition software is now being used to ID people for driver's licenses. Your photo is scanned and becomes a digital face print. Your image can be picked out from thousands of photos and video footage. The federal government is developing rules to allow unmanned surveillance drones to fly overhead. Drones were already authorized to patrol Vermont's border with Canada. Cameras on drones can capture what's going on below. We can hardly go anywhere without being tracked or creating a digital trail that pinpoints our whereabouts. That's a creepy feeling when you think about it. We don't like to be followed like criminals. How has all this happened? Since 9/11, the federal government has enlisted local police to help in counterterrorism efforts. The Department of Homeland Security has given Vermont police millions of dollars to buy high-tech surveillance tools. The money often goes straight to police departments. Review is limited. The surveillance upgrades have come into Vermont quietly. Without much discussion. Nobody's asking whether spending all this money and buying all this equipment is really making anyone safer, not to mention whether it's destroying our privacy. The courts rarely get involved because police say they're just monitoring activities anyone can see or detect. You might be thinking, I haven't done anything wrong. Why is all this information being collected about me? Can they do this? Good questions. Government isn't supposed to pry into our lives unless we're suspected of breaking the law. Does the NSA get any of this data? We've been hearing a lot about them. We don't know. It's hard to find out what information the NSA is and isn't collecting and storing. We do know that the NSA has records of all of our phone calls. It probably has access to our internet communications, and it can most likely get our credit card records and other financial transactions. And we do know that the Vermont Fusion Center, officially called the Vermont Information and Analysis Center, is storing some data collected by Vermont officials, such as license plate data. And some of the Fusion Center's data is shared among police agencies. That's the point of the center, a place where all sorts of information gets stored for future use. There's a Fusion Center in every state, but few people know what's happening at them because there's very little oversight. A congressional committee last year said Fusion Centers waste money. The centers don't do what they're designed to do, which is to fight terrorism, and they too often step on people's rights. What's going on? Why don't we know more about this stuff? Government is accountable to us, isn't it? Not the other way around. Dial in, listen up to protect your rights. Catch the ACLU's report, Surveillance on the Northern Border. Go to acluvt.org.
So, this is the report that we put out. We made this whiteboard video. It's called a whiteboard video. A really talented artist in the Burlington area helped us with this. And we used the online video to try and promote interest in the report. What I'm going to do tonight is talk about what's in the report, try to give you an overview of what we discovered, because this really was an adventure for us. We had some inkling that there were more surveillance tools coming to Vermont, and we had heard about drones. We had kind of heard about these special cameras police have to record license plates. We had found out about cell phone tracking, but we wanted to know more about these things and to get a sense of how pervasive the use of surveillance tools was in Vermont. What we did this fall was we got our whiteboard video out on Constitution Day, which is September 17th. We released our report at a press conference in Montpelier. One of the tools we used to get the press interested in the story was we actually got a drone and flew a drone over the State House and recorded a video of what the drone was able to capture when it was looking down. And I'll show that to you a little bit later in the presentation. It's kind of fun. We also had a follow-up conference at the end of October with a fellow by the name of William Arkin. If you follow national security and military analysis, you will have heard of Arkin. He's written a number of books. A few years ago, he and Dana Priest together put together a series of stories that ran in the Washington Post, later became a book, about the development of the surveillance industry as part of what we used to think of as the military-industrial complex. A really interesting series. So our purpose in all this has been to try to make people aware of what's happening here in Vermont. I mean, this is probably happening in other states as well, but I think sometimes in Vermont we tend to think we're different. These things don't happen to us, nobody's spying on us. And the reality is that there is indeed a lot of surveillance going on. We really started our report with two questions in mind. The first was, what's happened around surveillance and privacy? And then the second question was, how has this happened? It seems like we haven't really, when all the NSA stuff broke this summer, why did we not have an idea that that was happening already? So after we finished our research work, we really boiled down our answers to those two questions to four main points. And let me give you those points as sort of the introduction to my talk, and then we're going to dig down into some of the surveillance tools and how they're used. So the first point that we came up with was that we used to indeed be a state where both the notion and the reality of privacy were true. There really was privacy, there was anonymity in Vermont. I'm here to tell you that's no longer the case. Over the last 12 years, Vermont has really been transformed into a state where we're being watched. almost any time of the day, you can't go anywhere without being tracked, or creating a trail of digital information through the things that you do, using a credit card, for example. So day after day, hour after hour, our location is being recorded in some fashion. Okay, that's the first point. The second point is that some of the changes that have occurred have been dramatic. We were made aware that they might happen, or maybe they were already happening. Other changes were nearly imperceptible. They happened, maybe we knew about them, maybe we didn't. Some changes were secret, and I think the NSA stuff we've been learning about this summer is a good example of that. And then there were still other changes that we brought on ourselves. And the best example of that is these little guys, which we carry in our pockets, and I've forgotten to turn mine off, which I'm going to do right now so it doesn't go off. Whenever you have your cell phone on, and sometimes even when you don't have it turned on, it's a tracking device. And when you think about it, it has to be a tracking device, because how else is a cell tower going to be able to find this phone, and how is your phone going to be able to find a cell tower in order to receive or make a call? Well, I'll describe for you in a minute what it means to have that kind of communication between a tower and a cell phone. So that was point two. Point three is that since 9/11, the federal government has channeled a lot of money into the states to buy anti-terrorism devices, mainly surveillance tools. Vermont has gotten $100 million, slightly over $100 million in federal money from the Department of Homeland Security, and that's gone to law enforcement to buy high-tech tools and other surveillance paraphernalia. One of the things that's happened because of the way the money has come into the state is that most of us don't know very much about these tools, because unlike money that comes directly to a local government like town of Brattleboro or to state government like state of Vermont, there's been no appropriation process that you normally have when a select board or when the legislature has to authorize the expenditure of funds for specific things. Instead, the federal money has come to a large degree direct to law enforcement agencies, and they've used it to buy all sorts of surveillance tools, many of which I think most of us have not known very much about. So that's point three. Point four is something that at first you're going to think doesn't apply to you, but it actually does. And that is that most of Vermont is within a broad border zone that extends 100 miles from any international boundary. And you might be thinking, we're not 100 miles from an international boundary here in Brattleboro. And the reality is, you are. And that is because of the seacoast. You and almost all of New England, except for a very small slice of southwestern Vermont, basically Bennington County, we're all within 100 miles of an international border. And why is that important? It's important because the federal government, the Border Patrol, Customs and Border Protection, as they're formally called, claim the authority to do certain things within that 100 miles from the border that they otherwise would not be able to do. I think most of us, if you've gone to Canada or gone out of the country and come back in, you're used to being searched, possibly. When you come into the country, you know that your car can be searched at the border without a warrant, but you'd never think that the Border Patrol would be operating 100 miles from the border, and it actually does. The net result of these four things is that we all have become caught in webs of surveillance. It could be that the purpose of these tools was not to build that kind of a system, not to build a web of surveillance tracking us all the time. But the reality is, that's how all these tools together can be used. And that's why we say we really are now living in a society where we're being watched. So let's take a closer look at some of the tools that are being used. Or, These little gizmos on the back of this state police trooper, trooper's cruiser, those two boxes are actually cameras. They're called ALPRs, automated license plate readers. And what it is it's a device that uses a digital camera and what's called optical character recognition software to read the numbers and letters on license plates. So those cameras, as you go whizzing by, or as the car goes by you, and where you're parked in a parking lot, it creates an image of your license plate. And it also adds to the image a geolocation stamp, so it pinpoints exactly where the car is, and it also stamps the date and the time. So the image of the license plate is connected to location and also time. The main reason that these systems were developed is for police to find people who were wanted for specific crimes, outstanding warrant, or maybe hadn't paid a traffic ticket and they wanted to make sure that they could get you to pay that ticket. So every morning, the police in this state receive what's called a hot list. A hot list is a list of license plate numbers of cars owned, driven by people the police would like to talk to, because you have an outstanding warrant, you haven't paid a traffic ticket, or whatnot. The problem is that in the process of finding whether you are, let's say you're wanted for an outstanding warrant on, you haven't paid child support. What happens is your license plate gets entered into a database as it's being checked against the hot list, and that database is saved. It's first saved on a computer inside the cruiser, and then when the officer returns to the station or the barracks, he or she downloads that information into a central database that is in Waterbury. It's at the Department of Public Safety. So all the information from all these cameras is being recorded and retained. It's retained in the central database of the Department of Public Safety, and it eventually ends up in something called a fusion center, which is located in Williston. And a little bit later, I'll describe for you what a fusion center is. Here's the civil liberties problem. Proponents, police, of ALPR systems, automated license plate reader systems, try to argue that this system is no different than when a police officer might stand at a corner with a pad of paper and a pen writing down license plate numbers. The problem is that these things are really vastly different than a police officer doing that. As somebody has written, unlike a human police officer, an ALPR, quote, captures everything, forgets nothing, and never gets tired or distracted. It captures digital images that can be viewed at any time, from any place, as many times as desired, and can be modified and used well beyond the original intent of either the image collector or the subject. There are about 36 different police agencies in the state that now have these cameras. They're located all around the state. These cameras are capable of capturing 1,800 plates an hour. So in one officer's eight-hour shift of using these things, he or she can capture 14,400 plates, and that's from one of the cameras. Our privacy is affected whenever government officers record movements of individuals who aren't subject to an investigation. Unlike an officer who's investigating a crime, these devices are being used as a matter of technological routine. There's no warrant requirement for their use. There's no judicial oversight. When the data collected from each of the readers all around the state is aggregated, the various GPS locations at which the cameras read the license plate, as well as the date and timestamp, can reveal where a person has traveled. So if they've got your license plate and the data's been aggregated, they could actually try to determine where you took your yearly leaf peeping trip this past fall. It can become that precise. Right now, the Vermont system does not have a direct connection to the Department of Motor Vehicle System for determining whose car is whose. So what the police in Vermont have to do is they have to physically pick up a telephone, cell phone, and make a call to the DMV before they know whose license plate is attached to whose name. But we're very close, in other states they're doing this already, we're very close to having a system where you can simply type in the license plate, know who it is, and know where that car has been sighted around the state. For the most part, legislatures are in the states, and also the federal government, have not been very far ahead of ALPRs. There are very few laws around the country that regulate the use of these things. That actually did change here in Vermont last year when we and a few other privacy people worked to get a bill passed in the legislature, bill number S18, to regulate the data and how long it's kept and who has access to it. So it used to be that police could keep this data indefinitely. They were, in fact, keeping it about 4 years before getting rid of it. And we convinced the legislature to set a limit of 18 months. We wanted it to be 7 days, but we didn't win on that one. 18 months struck the legislature as somewhere halfway between 7 days and 4 years, I guess. So the data is kept 18 months, and it can be retained longer if police go to a court and make what's called a preservation request. If there's been, well, the example that was always used during the legislative discussions was, I don't know if you remember the disappearance and subsequent determination, the murder of the couriers in Essex Junction about 3 years ago. For a very long time, that case was a pretty cold case. And eventually, it was the confession of some guy in Alaska that led police to realize that it was the guy confessing the crime himself who had carried out the murder of the couriers here in Vermont. Police have said that if we could have had automated license plate reader cameras in the area at that time, we might have wanted to retain that data to see who was there, and we might have gotten to this suspect much sooner. So, that's automated license plate readers. Let's go on to this guy. This is my cell phone. And as I was saying, when you think about it, by definition, these things have to be tracking devices. So a communications tower can know where you are to send a phone call to you. So by their very nature, these things are invasive of your privacy. The convenience of having a cell phone really comes at a high price, and the high price is your privacy. The way that your whereabouts can be determined is by triangulating the cell towers that your phone is interacting with. Your past movements can be reconstructed by examining the data transmission that's stored by the cell phone companies. This actually is a page from records that were sought by a police agency from, I think it was AT&T. And it basically is giving you GPS coordinates, dates, times, so that police can look at this and can actually determine where I was when I had this cell phone with me. That's not
just
my number.
Just with you or when you were using it?
No, it's when it's with you.
Just with you.
It's with you. Because about every 7 minutes, your cell phone is sending a signal out to try to find towers. And the towers are confirming the signal by sending a signal back to your phone. If you want to do something interesting sometime, if you have a computer with wireless like this one does, put your cell phone, when it's on, next to the computer. And if you have speakers connected, you'll hear a beeping like a Morse code about every 7 to 10 minutes, even though you're not getting a phone call. And that's the communication between the tower and this guy.
But if the phone is off.
Some phones, even when you think they're off, still have their GPS on, and it can pick up that signal. So you sometimes, literally, on some phones, you have to open up the phone and take out the battery to turn the phone off. So How did we know about cell phone tracking data? Well, in 2010, we got involved in a lawsuit with the Attorney General's office. When we asked the Attorney General for any records, we made a public records request, any records of the of a police agency in Vermont, including the AG's office, obtaining cell phone tracking data. And the request was denied, and so we appealed the denial of the request for the public records. And we got into court, and a judge finally decided that we at least had the right to know whether any records responsive to our request existed. We might not have the right to see the records, but the Attorney General's office had to produce what's called a Vaughn Index, named for a lawsuit from a number of years ago. A Vaughn Index is a list of the documents government might have that are relevant to the public records request you're making. And when the AG's office produced a Vaughn Index, we found out that indeed police in this state are getting cell phone tracking data without getting a warrant. They are, we're pretty sure, using a secret court proceeding called an inquest, where basically police assert in a court, and we think sometimes there's a judge there, sometimes they're not. They assert that they need certain information for an investigation they have underway. There's no determination of probable cause that probably this person has committed a crime, nothing like that. There just has to be a suspicion that somebody might have committed a crime, a lower standard, and so they're able to get the records. In 2011, which is the last year I saw for how many requests for cell phone tracking data around the country were being made, in 2011, local states, law enforcement, and the FBI requested 1.3 million phone records to try to determine where people were from their cell phones. 1.3 million. The other interesting thing about this, and what makes the relationship between the police and the phone companies even more problematic, the phone companies sell this information to the police. They bill the police every time a record like this is generated. So there is actually a revenue stream for the telecommunications companies essentially selling your phone records to the police. They're usually fairly happy to do it. So here's the civil liberties problem. The civil liberties problem is that when police go fishing for information without a finding of probable cause by a judge, it's a violation of the Fourth Amendment. The Fourth Amendment says you should be free of unreasonable searches and seizure. A search becomes reasonable only when a police officer goes to a judge and gets a warrant, then the police officer presents the warrant to you or whoever is the target of the warrant, and the police are allowed to search in a specific place for specific things. That's not happening in most places with the production of these phone records. A few courts in a few states or federal jurisdictions have said that a warrant should be required, but in most states that's not happened. It hasn't happened in this state. This is surely to come before the Supreme Court in the next couple of years. It's a really hot issue. Okay, let's move on to facial recognition software. If you have something as basic as, I think the operating system on my computer is Windows 7, your computer actually has a built-in facial recognition system. You can search through your entire computer database for a photographic image in the same way that you can search through your Word documents for a word or a phrase that will take you to the documents that have those words or phrases. So I can actually, in my computer, say I want to find all the pictures that have me in them, that are on my files, and I push a button and within 5 seconds, I've got 50 different photos of me. It just searches through the entire photo database, and using facial recognition software, it pulls me up. It's exactly what Facebook does when a photo gets tagged on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden you're getting messages saying, oh, Alan Gilbert, you were tagged in a photo by your son, William Gilbert. And sure enough, I'll go to his Facebook page, and without my saying, oh, that's me, that's Alan Gilbert, Facebook knew, based on facial recognition, who it was and actually tagged the photo automatically.
Can you teach us how to do that later?
It's been a while since I've done it. It's really pretty easy. I forget where it is. It's pretty amazing. I mean, really, it's there, you know? I didn't even know I had it. So the way it works is, I don't know if you can see all these blue points on these photographs. These are different places on your face that are points that are being measured. And essentially what facial recognition is doing is it's not searching for an image the way you think of a photograph. It's actually using an algorithm that is produced by measuring the distance between those different points on your face. And the algorithms are precise enough because they're zeroing in on things that apparently are very difficult to change through plastic surgery. And also, after you're fully grown, don't change anymore over time. So the images have fairly high reliability. We now have facial recognition in Vermont thanks to a $900,000 grant from the Department of Homeland Security to the Department of Motor Vehicles. When you get a license now, a driver's license, and you have to have a new picture taken, it will come with an algorithm because facial recognition software is being applied to all new photos. That means that the photos that the DMV holds will eventually be searchable to find every single one of us, not just by name, but by image. It means also that if police would like to try to find a picture of somebody who they think was at the scene of something, they could make a request of the DMV, and the DMV could search through all the photos in their database to come up with the person who may have been where the police say. Everybody else, all of us who are in that database, are having our photos searched as well. Generally, police are not supposed to be able to search for things like that without some sort of a warrant that's been given by a judge indicating that you might have committed a crime because of evidence the police put before a judge. It's as though the DMV photos are a virtual police lineup that makes us all suspects all the time. When the DMV first got this software 2 years ago, they got the money for it, I should say, they stated that they were not going to allow police access to the database, that the only purpose of the database was for the Department of Motor Vehicles to make sure that people were not trying to get multiple driver's licenses. Believe it or not, there are people in this state who have as many as, I think the record is, 43 aliases. They have different identities, and one of the ways they do it is they get multiple driver's licenses. With facial recognition software, it's going to be a lot harder to falsify licenses or to use somebody else's picture to get one for yourself. Facial recognition software. So let's move on to drones. Drones are technically unmanned aerial vehicles. They range in size and capability, and they're operated through remote piloting. Their initial use was in war zones. This is a Tomahawk drone that's on display at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington. So the fact it's on display at the Smithsonian tells you it's been around a while, and this is not brand new technology. Some of the drones, the older drones, and the current military ones, they're equipped with surveillance and sometimes also weapons. I think we've all read, because of the war in Afghanistan and to some extent in Iraq, Drones have been used in very high numbers to do both surveillance and also so-called targeted strikes. To have the kind of capability that the military drones have, which is to stay airborne for a long period of time and to be able to carry a heavy payload, either a weapon of some sort or a heavy camera, they have to be fairly large. And this one in the Smithsonian is fairly large. However, what's been happening is that the people who make drones have realized that there are probably all sorts of civilian adaptations or uses for drones. And so manufacturers have started to make domestic drones, drones that you and I can buy online or in hobby shops. This is what's called an octocopter. It's made of plastic. It's a plastic device. It's got eight wings coming out. And on the end of each of these wings is a blade, a helicopter blade. It spins around. It's controlled by the speed of the helicopter blade, I believe, in any one of those arms. So it can tilt and it can veer to the right, it can veer to the left. This one, it's got a landing cage. You'll see the skids that it lands on. And then there's a basket right here beneath the orange bulb. And that's where a camera can be mounted so that when you fly the drone, video or still photos can be taken. These things, when you think about it, could have a number of different uses. You might be thinking about buying a piece of property near your house, and you're interested in, I don't know, the health of the trees. It's a forested property. And you want to know the health of the trees and maybe what kind of trees are there. You could have a drone fly over that forest and get a look from the top at what sorts of trees are there and what their health might be. If you're a newspaper operation, you'd probably love to have a drone that could be used to fly over, I don't know, a demonstration, to fly over a big gathering, to fly over a rock concert, any of number of things. If you're the police, you'd probably also like to have a drone to do everything from a benign use, such as searching for a lost hiker, to something not so benign, which is searching for somebody growing marijuana in some remote location. This would be a lot cheaper than getting a helicopter to do the same thing. So you're probably thinking, yeah, right. So are people really using these things that way? So I mentioned when we released our surveillance report back in September at the State House, we actually got a drone and we did a flyover of the State House. So this is in front of the State House on September 17th. News reporters around. This guy leaning over the drone is the operator from, we borrowed a drone from Vermont Community Access Media in Burlington. They had actually bought this drone. It's a quadricopter. It's only got four blades on it. They had bought this drone for a special project that they had signed up for to survey the health of trees in Burlington. They bought the drone to fly over the trees so they could get a view of the crowns of all the trees to determine if they were healthy. What could it see? This is what the drone captured when it flew. Governor's office, in case you're wondering. We thought it'd be fun to see what was going on there.
Can you wave back?
What?
Can you wave back?
This is the Supreme Court building by the State House. So, $650. You can buy that quadricopter for $650. It's controlled by an application you download for your smartphone. It can stay up in the air for about 9 minutes on a single battery charge. And what people generally do is they have a number of battery packs, so they go up for flights of 9 minutes, come back, put in another battery pack, and they're up again. If you lose sight of the drone, or the drone starts wandering off on its own, after a certain point, it determines it's got to get home before the battery runs out, and there's a built-in homing device. So it comes back to the point from which you launched it. This is all for $650.
Including the camera?
Including the camera.
Not the music?
No, the music's not included. So yeah, that was edited down. I mean, we took about three different flights that day, so we have, I don't know, 25 minutes worth of footage, and that was edited down to about a minute. It gets pretty boring watching these things for 25 minutes just flying in the air, believe me. But it's just astounding, the capability of something that's that cheap, what it can record. And I think the civil liberties problem is obvious. You know, what does privacy mean when one of those things could be flying over your house? And we were talking about this at dinner tonight. It's going to be a real Wild West when there are a lot of these things flying around, and there will be.
What is the law with respect to the air above you? Who owns that?
There's very little law. There's a Vermont Supreme Court decision regarding a search by police in a helicopter. I shouldn't say a search. By a flight over a person's home, police in a helicopter, and they found the person growing marijuana in a greenhouse. And they had footage of this. They went to the person's home, and they knocked on the door and arrested him for cultivation and possession of pot. The homeowner appealed the charge, and it went all the way to the Vermont Supreme Court. The question was whether that was a legal search without a warrant. Police didn't have a warrant. And the court ruled that it was. Currently, these things, the hobby drones, are thought of as just a model airplane. You know, there are people who have been flying radio-controlled airplanes for quite some time. I mean, you usually see them, I don't know, at some abandoned airport or something somewhere, or in a big field. And those you can fly legally. You have to keep to within 400 feet. You can't go above that in the airspace. And you have to have a direct line of sight. But you're allowed to fly those things. That's currently what drones, that's the only regulation for drones. That's an FAA, a Federal Aviation Administration regulation. What's happening now is that Congress has realized that there are going to be many more drones flying in this country very soon. What's the estimate? The estimate is that 30,000 domestic drones could be deployed in the next decade. So the FAA has been charged by Congress with, by 2015, coming up with regulations for how drones can be flown in public space, the air above us. So the question is, can a drone fly over your house, record images, invade your privacy? Currently, I think what would happen is, I don't think you don't own the space above your house. So it's not trespassing in that sense. But if somebody starts flying a drone over your house, it could qualify as harassment or stalking. Or it could be disorderly conduct. I mean, there are some laws in place now that could possibly be applied to them. The real question is going to be when police start using these things. Currently, no police agency in the state has said they have a drone. The Department of Public Safety Commissioner has said there's no plans by the state police or anybody else to get drones. But you can bet your bottom dollar police are going to have these drones, and it's only a matter of time. And I'd be surprised within the next year if at least one or two departments didn't have some of these things.
Could they run into each other? I mean, if you could get a lot of
30,000? Sounds to me like it could happen. Yeah.
Let's say one of these is flying around over my house that I decide I want to exercise my second amendment rights and pull out my AR.
Yeah, this always comes up. I don't know. You know, yeah, you probably would have liability, so there'd probably be a civil suit against you. I don't know if you could be accused of a crime. I mean, you can't really shoot a gun up in the air, correct, because of the danger of the bullet falling someplace and injuring somebody. So potentially you could be charged with that. There must be some statute about wanton destruction of personal property. You could probably be charged with that. I mean, there's so many laws on the books that I'm sure there are several that could be applied to you. But it's a good question. I mean, do you have a right to take a pot shot at one because you think it's harassing you? And my guess is no, just like you can't shoot at an airplane that you think is too low over your house, unless it's simply flying in a pattern right above your house. And then you have a right to complain. This is going to be a really interesting area of the law, of interactions among people. There's a bill in Congress. Representative Welch actually introduced a bill to regulate both police use of drones and private use of drones. And his idea for regulating police use is you have to get a warrant, and his idea for private use is that you have to file a flight plan. So, you know, is actually kind of clever, because that's what airliners have to do. And the idea is that if you're something like a newspaper and you have a drone and it's part of your regular business, you can file an ongoing flight plan notifying the public that you fly the drone to, you know, over Church Street in Burlington every morning at 10 o'clock just to see what's going on. And all the reports would be on a website, so that if you thought you saw a drone and you wanted to know what was up, you could go to the website and find out whose drone it was. There's a drone bill in the legislature here in Vermont. It was introduced at the end of the session last year. It would regulate police use by requiring a warrant before surveillance could be done with the drone by police. This is going to be a Wild West for a while. It's really going to be interesting. Okay, let me show you this thing that I alluded to at the beginning of my talk, this 100-mile zone. This is a map of the United States with 100 miles marked from any international border. So you can see up here in Vermont, or up here in New England, practically all of New England is covered by the 100-mile zone, except for a tiny corner of Vermont, sort of below the E in Manchester. 94% of Vermonters live within this 100-mile zone. Only the people, again, in Bennington County who are outside of it. And what that means is that the Border Patrol asserts that they have jurisdiction within this area broader than what you or I might think. This comes from a court decision in the 1970s, which allowed the Border Patrol to operate and do searches under certain conditions and traffic stops, not just at the border, but beyond the border. And there are actually different layers, different zones, where they can do different things based on different reasons. But the ultimate zone that they can operate in is 100 miles. That is why, if you remember, back in 2003, 2004, there was sometimes a traffic stop on I-91 just south of White River. That was the Border Patrol operating what's called a temporary checkpoint. That spot is 94 miles from the Canadian border. They knew exactly what they were doing. And what they did, if you went through, they were stopping every car, and they were asking if you were a U.S. citizen. Simple question.
But the odd thing was they shut down weekends, so if you wanted to sneak through, you just drive on a Sunday.
If you wanted to sneak through, you just got off at the exit before, got on Route 5, went 3 miles, and then got back on. These things, they became really a point of contention because Patrick Leahy was stopped at one of these stops. and was asked to he was asked if he was a U.S. citizen, and he got really angry apparently and started contacting the Department of Homeland Security. And I must admit, shortly after that, most of the checkpoints stopped operating. One of them cropped up a little bit later, and there was one in New Hampshire, right across the river in Hanover, that operated briefly, or Lebanon, I forget which. But they haven't been operating since then. One of the things that we found when we were doing our report is back in, I think it was 2007, the Department of Homeland Security commissioned a study to determine sites along all the interstate highways, the north-south interstate highways in New England and eastern New York, as to where a permanent checkpoint could be built within 100 miles from the border. So there are plans, it's not quite all the highways, but I think there are plans for I-95, I-91, I-89, and I-87. There are actually documents, we have them in our office, that show you different sites that were looked at for building a fairly extensive complex that would be a Border Patrol checkpoint within the country. Those plans are now on the shelf. There was a big outcry, again, from Patrick Leahy, among other people. And the Border Patrol has said they're on the shelf, we're not going to use them. And you know what that really means. When there's an opportunity to bring them off the shelf, you can bet that they'll be active with them.
Can you comment on the reasoning behind that? Because, as you just pointed out, the further it is into the interior, the more opportunities there are to drive around it if you don't those are. So what's the point of having that, you know, 90 miles from the border instead of right at the border?
Well, they would continue to have them right at the border. But what they want is another net where they might be able to stop people. And I think the problem is that, I mean, come on, any terrorist worth his or her salt is going to have a website and it's going to tell you exactly where these interior checkpoints are, and they will describe the route you have to take to avoid them. I mean, it's really, to my mind, it's what's often called security theater. It's not really doing anything effectively to fight, to try to catch people coming into the country illegally to do harm. It's just making the rest of us feel better that the Border Patrol has all these agents out stopping people on the highway. It's really not good. Yeah.
How much confidence should we really have in the validity of these data that are being gathered? What kind of error checks are there? And my understanding is once the data get in there, that it's very, very difficult, almost impossible to review it.
Well, that's one of the things that's coming out with the NSA stuff. I mean, how effective is this? Isn't part of the problem that they're collecting so much data that they don't know how to sort through it? One of the things that was happening at the permanent, the temporary checkpoint at White River Junction was we got a lot of complaints from people, minorities, who reported a much higher rate of being stopped than white Europeans. If you had somebody in your car who was Hispanic, African American, Middle East, Eastern, or Asian, your chance of being asked more than simply, are you a U.S. citizen, went up dramatically. And we believe there was profiling going on, but it's very hard to determine that without a huge statistical study, and that requires a lot of time and a lot of resources and getting it a lot of documents. So once you start profiling people, usually the error rate starts going up very high, because profiling is generally not a good way to solve a crime or to get information about people, because it's not necessarily connected at all any more than somebody's style of shoe that they're wearing is. So a lot of the stuff that's been happening since 2001 really has been done simply because it's what they've always done when the country has felt threatened and it's not particularly effective.
Well, how much of this is really self-serving? I mean, a lot of it, you've got, and then You want to protect your industry. The more money you get, the more affluence you can have with this, the more things you can buy, the more things you can enjoy in that particular.
Well, it's what Dwight Eisenhower warned about in the military-industrial complex speech he made, that once a country begins to become almost fixated with military prowess, whether for defense or offense, you build an establishment of similar interests who have a very strong self-serving interest in continuing to sell products to the military. And the same is true in surveillance and security. I mean, the drones are a great example of that. The drone manufacturing lobby has become very strong in Washington. Let me just...
Yeah, I was going to say that there's probably a lot of potential profit behind all of this, because even to read the data, they'll probably eventually farm it out, because our police departments are so poor. So we'll get, you know, it just creates private business.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
not,
I mean,
not for the people who are making minimum wage.
Yeah, you have to make the cameras. You got to make the, you have to make the drones. You have to hire people to go through the data. You have to buy computers to hold the data. I mean, there's a self-generating, built-in longevity to this stuff.
Yeah.
Does anybody know what that is?
Oh, that's the NSA.
That's the NSA. Headquarters in Washington, not the big data center that they're building out in the desert of Utah somewhere.
Jesus.
So this is the NSA, and we've all been hearing a lot about the NSA, and it looks like a pretty big, forbidding place that is very far from us. But there's something called a fusion center in every state in the country, including Vermont. Fusion centers were funded by the Department of Homeland Security, and their purpose was to collect information, aggregate information, to try to prevent terrorist attacks. Again, it was a post 9/11 activity. Vermont's Fusion Center is in Williston, just outside of Burlington. And we're not quite sure exactly what kind of data they're collecting there. We know that's where the automated license plate reader data ends up, because when we were working on the bill last year in the legislature, they described the data stream and who has custody of it at various points. And eventually, it does end up at the Fusion Center in Williston. The Fusion Center is not a very glamorous place. It used to be right behind the state police barracks up there, and now I think it's been moved to a facility near one of the federal facilities for Customs and Immigration in South Burlington, but I'm not sure. The question for us about a fusion center, whether it's in Vermont or New York or Massachusetts or Iowa or whatever, is what kind of information is being collected there? How is it being collected? Why is it being retained, and how long is it being retained? And how is it searched? How are the different databases aggregated? One thing that seems clear is that fusion centers and the NSA as well get their data not just from what the government collects, you know, through the NSA telephone metadata program, for example, but they also buy data from private companies. And I think all of you have probably read enough by now about what happens when you go on the web, even doing something as innocent as writing an email, or when you go to a shopping site to buy something. All sorts of cookies are tracking where you've been, what you've done. So you'll notice that if you start searching on cheap airfares to Cancun because you'd like to get away from the snow and the cold, probably the next time you go online, maybe go do some Gmail writing, you will have ads on the right side of the page for cheap Air Mexico flights to Cancun. It's because they knew that you were searching for flights on kayak.com to Cancun. And that information about you has been sold to a data aggregator that has then resold it to other companies to use to advertise products to you. So there's a big, huge world of data out there, and we don't know how the different data centers are interacting. We don't know if the Fusion Center in Vermont is directly connected to the NSA, or if the NSA wants nothing to do with the Vermont Fusion Center. My guess is there is some sort of connection, but we're not quite sure exactly what it is.
How about with New Hampshire or a neighboring state?
What usually, I can tell you what happens with the automated license plate reader data that is in the Vermont Fusion Center. If you're a Vermont officer, you can make a request of the Fusion Center for access to what's called the historical data, the data that's being saved there for up to 18 months. If you're from New Hampshire, or for that matter, any other state in the country, you can work through your department to make a formal request to the Vermont Fusion Center. The bill that was passed last year sets out a procedure for who reviews the request and the records that have to be kept, noting who the request was from and who granted it or denied it. And every year, the Fusion Center or the Department of Public Safety has to submit a report to the legislature as to how many requests for that data were made. So at least there's going to be some sense of how often the data is being accessed, which is something. I want to show you what to me is the real story behind all of this. We've been talking about information and data, and what we've all forgotten because we've gotten so used to how computers always get faster and bigger and cheaper. You know, imagine if cars were like that. They got, well, maybe not necessarily bigger, but faster and cheaper and better. They don't do that. Computers do. The cost of storing a gigabyte of data in 1980 was $500,000. What is that? 33 years later, it's now a nickel. So it now is almost literally true. It's cheaper to store whatever you have than to sort through it and figure out what you want to get rid of. You just buy more storage. It's cheap. And it's only going to get cheaper. The other thing that this ability to amass information and store it has meant is that an agency like the NSA, every 14.4 minutes, the NSA collects the contents of another Library of Congress. So I've been talking an hour. So that's what, four times that. So in the 1 hour I've been talking, four Libraries of Congress have been added to what the NSA has been collecting. And it goes on 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, for as long as we let them do it. So I'm going to stop there because it seems like people have a lot of questions. I was asked this evening if I would make people paranoid, and if you're like me, you get pretty paranoid about this stuff. But you do want to be careful not to get too paranoid, because you want to be able to ask reasonable questions and get reasonable answers to some of these things. Big data is going to be with us forever, and the question is, how do you regulate it and how do you put bounds on it? Let me just go back there because you...
Well, you also, you hop on to my question. The authority is going to say, hey, if you're innocent, you've got nothing to worry about. But we do worry. And of course, in the wrong hands and in a different political time, this could be serious for all of us. But can you get to the essence in some founding philosophy of why this really cuts across the American grain?
Yeah, because in 1772, there was a famous trial in Boston of a merchant who was accused of smuggling. As you probably remember from American history, smuggling became rampant in the American colonies because of all the duties that the Crown was imposing on the colonists to pay for various wars. The Crown started using, to try to attack the smugglers, they started using not warrants, but something called a writ of assistance. And a writ of assistance, often called just a writ, was essentially an open-ended search warrant. instead of having a search warrant that stated what you were looking for, where it was, and for how long the search warrant was good for a search, the writs of assistance were general search warrants where you could essentially, the Crown's agents could enter your home or your business at any time, look for anything, and do it whenever they wanted. A merchant in Boston challenged this, I think it was 1772, and his lawyer was James Otis. And Otis put on a defense that an Englishman's right to be left alone in his home or business, you know, your home is your castle kind of thing, should prevent the use of these general writs of assistance. And it became a very famous trial that lasted for a fairly long time, is my understanding. And in the end, the Crown won. The judge determined that the writs of assistance were legal. But there was, John Adams sitting in on that trial, and to him, that's when independence was born in this country. When there was a recognition, at least on the part of the American colonists, that one of the most important values in what became our country is the right to be left alone by government, unless government has a specific suspicion that you have committed a crime. You can go into the smuggler's business to look for smuggled goods if you have evidence that the person has committed a crime. Otherwise, your home, your business, are your castle. And government should leave you alone. That's what the Fourth Amendment is. The Fourth Amendment says you have a right to be left alone unless a lawful warrant is issued by a judge, and the warrant is supported, the application for the warrant is supported by information in an affidavit stating the reasons why you think Alan Gilbert probably committed a crime, and there is probably evidence in his house, maybe in a kitchen drawer, that you want to try to get. And if the judge believes you and thinks that there's probable cause that Alan Gilbert committed the crime, the judge will grant the warrant. But without the warrant, the police cannot come into your house unless you give your consent and search your house. It is as American as the American Revolution. I mean, we really do prize our privacy. Historically, we have. And it's really being tested now because the kind of privacy that we've become used to, which is to be let alone generally and to be anonymous if we want, is really under siege. It is very hard today to be anonymous in this country. Very hard. In the back.
Do you think that the U.S. is heading in the direction of maybe like London, as far as being like the most surveilled city in the entire world, actually, place in the entire world is London. So
right.
I mean, as far as it goes, it's all legal, and actually, the British people, to a large extent, feel that it's appropriate. So, do you think the U.S. eventually will go in that direction?
Yeah, what he's talking about, the U.K. but especially London in the UK, has set up myriad security cameras, surveillance cameras, all around, and they're all connected. They all feed their images into a central database, and facial recognition software is used to go through those images so you can determine when somebody you might be looking for was at any given time. And the question is, are we headed in that direction in the US? And I would say, yes, we are. But I think the challenges are much greater simply because of the much greater size of the country and the much greater population and the problems of networking the different surveillance camera systems and using common data that allows facial recognition software to be used effectively. I mean, one of the things I do in my job at the ACLU is to follow the success of creating e-medical records. You know, Vermont is supposed to have all of our medical records digitized within a couple of years, and our records are going to be shared among healthcare providers, our doctors, our hospitals, and so forth. You cannot believe the difficulty they're having in getting different computer systems talking to each other. you cannot believe the problems they're having in just getting a consistent way for notes to be taken about your visit to your doctor. Some doctors, believe it or not, will write numbers in letters. So 70 becomes S-E-V-E-N-T-Y. Other doctors will use the number 7, number 70. You can't imagine all the complicated factors that come into play when you're trying to standardize systems that aren't planned from the start to be completely integrated. America seems to be famously set in not having the kinds of standards that certainly European countries do for certain tech systems or mechanical systems so that things work together. You know, Germany has had the DIN system, the DIN system, for years and years, and it stands for Deutsche Industrie Norm, German industry norms, so that all industries do things according to a norm, things are standardized, things work together. I mean, we're still using inches when the rest of the world is using centimeters, for God's sakes. We're outliers. That, I think, more than anything else, is going to prevent systematic surveillance from happening. Go ahead.
I've been having a wonderful time listening to your presentation because I'm a 50-year veteran computer engineer. It is both works as both worse and better than you say. An example from today: my cousin, an unassuming retired Vermonter like me, went to renew her driver's license. They told her, "Come back with your certified birth certificate and your original Social Security card."
They want her to get a real ID.
Because you're going to get a real ID. And she said, "Can I get anything else?" And they said, "Well, you can for now, but by 2017." Everybody is going to have these. Now, what that actually...
That's not true, but go ahead.
Okay, fair enough. I'm glad to hear that. But, nevertheless, what I've been thinking about is, first, anything that does have an RFID can be read by a reader that you walk by.
Those are not going to have RFID chips. They're
they may not, them. However, the United States passport does have.
That's correct.
That's right.
That's correct.
Now, the reason I mention it is because there are pouches, foil-lined pouches you can get to put your passport in. Mm-hmm. You can put your cell phone in there, and your cell phone will be incommunicado. Now, so the reason it's better is I just idly thinking about it, I thought of three unobtrusive ways. I'm not sure all of them would work, but there certainly are ways that work. There's a lot of engineers out there and a lot of chemists to put something on a license plate so that yes, the camera will get a picture, but the OCR won't work. One of them is diffraction, which is physics. It cannot be defeated. Regarding your computer tracking you, there's all kinds of ways to prevent cookies from happening. But two words for you: flash cookies. If you don't know what those are, you're at every website you go to that uses flash is being logged. So you know there are lots of ways to defeat it. Here's two more. You're being bothered by a drone. First thing is go to the hardware store, get yourself one of those 1 million candle power spotlights, line the camera. The other thing is any radio amateur can teach you how to jam its electronic signal so it can no longer be controlled by the operator. In other words, we are not powerless in these situations. We all have the opportunity to be Edward Snowden's and defeat this stuff.
Are you a regular reader of Scientific American?
I am.
Yeah, I figured. Because it had a great article, great series of articles about two months ago, I guess by now, on surveillance and on drones, and it talked about that very thing, that you can jam the signals very easily at this point. And that's one of the major problems the FAA is facing, apparently, in trying to come up with regulations for how you control the airspace so it remains safe. Because currently, I gather, that the communication systems that drones use are not very good. They're not accurate, they're not secure, they can easily be defeated. So I think you're right, there are many things you can do. Can I just go back to the Real ID thing so people know what this is about? Real ID is a new driver's license that's been forced on the states, kind of forced, by they give you money to buy things like facial recognition software. So Vermont, as of January 1st, started offering what's called a Real ID. It is a driver's license and national identity card together. And this 2017 deadline by which you have to have the license that you related is supposedly the date after which you're not going to be able to get on an airplane or go inside a federal facility or a nuclear power plant for some reason without having this ID or another approved ID like a passport. So in other words, you can't flash your regular Vermont driver's license. You will continue to be able to have a regular non-real ID Vermont driver's license even after 2017, but you can only use it for driving. You're going to have to carry a passport or another form of federally approved ID, there's some weird ones, in order to get on an airplane. That's the plan. Whether it's going to happen or not, nobody knows for sure. You know you have, this is the most obnoxious thing about the whole Real ID program. When you get a Real ID license, it says for federal ID purposes, and there is a yellow star that is put on the license. It is creepy, yucky, and totally insensitive to anybody who knows anything about Holocaust history. I mean, it is just terrible. But that's what they all have around the country. So you don't have to get one of these things. If you do get it, by the way, if you do get it and they say you have to come back with a certified copy of your birth certificate, if your name is not exactly the same on the birth certificate as it is now, so if you've been married and you have taken as a last name your spouse's last name, you have got to get a certified copy of your marriage license and take that with your certified copy of your birth certificate and two other forms of ID, by the way, to the DMV before you can get one of these crazy licenses. Okay, I knew that. So let me, you had your hand up first.
Just trying to, this fellow came up with some interesting but somewhat sophisticated ways to counteract all of this surveillance.
No, he said they were pretty simple.
Yeah. Well, all right, that's a matter of opinion. But okay, I was thinking of more simple things, even more simple things. One, don't own a cell phone. Two, use cash instead of a credit card. And that takes care of a huge amount of data collection possibilities, I think. The next thing is wear big dark glasses, and finally, don't cut your hair, and that's what I'm working on.
It's coming naturally, right?
Well, okay, in the back, and then I'll come to you.
I found it very interesting when you mentioned, the question was, how did this all happen, come about? And the fact that the money for all this equipment is coming directly to the police forces. So are you saying then that they're actually, like for instance Brattleboro, they would bypass the town and the money would go directly to the police
force
or Burlington?
Yeah, this is a good question because nobody's quite clear how this has been operating. There actually is a Vermont Department of Homeland Security. I don't know if you realize that, but there is. And some of the federal money, it's my understanding, goes to them, and then they parcel it out to different agencies, from the state police to the Brattleboro police. And depending on your municipality, that grant of money may go through some sort of acceptance process on the local level, but in other places, I don't think it is.
So the town doesn't have any real control.
You're not raising the money. I mean, usually you have control of money when you as a voter have to approve the raising of the money, not just the expenditure. I mean, spending money is easy, right? The hard part is raising the money. So when you have town meeting, we all sit there and argue about the school budget or the town road budget. You're really controlling what you're going to spend by how much you agree to raise. When you don't have to raise the money because the federal government is giving it to you, there's a strong incentive to go out and spend it because it's not costing you anything. And there is an example of a town in Vermont that turned down the automated license plate reader cameras, and that's Norwich. Norwich had a very public debate about a year ago because the police chief came to the select board and told them what he was going to do. And I think the police chief himself actually had misgivings about the grant, and that's one of the reasons he went to the select board. And over a period of several meetings, the select board finally said, we don't want this money. But most towns have been happily taking the money. Okay, you're next.
So the smart meters, and I didn't get one specifically for that reason of them eventually being able to sort of get in.
Well, smart meters are interesting because they haven't been viewed as the same kind of surveillance tool as a lot of other things, but they're a great thing to talk about because, like cell phones, a private company, your utility, is collecting a lot of information about fairly private things, i.e. what's going on in your house. Smart meters eventually are going to communicate with every appliance in your home because every appliance will have an RFID chip, and it'll send a signal. The freezer will send a signal to the smart meter saying whenever it's drawing current and how much current and time of day and all that stuff. And eventually, you might be able to buy utility discounts based on when you say you will use electricity for certain appliances. So you might get a slightly reduced rate if you agree that your dishwasher cannot come on between 7 at night and 10 at night. And it'll be controlled automatically by the smart meter talking to the RFID chip in the dishwasher. All this is going to be data. All this is going to be stored by the utility. The question is, who should have access to that and under what circumstance? What if the police suspect you're growing pot down in your basement, lots of grow lamps, a lot of current being drawn? They'd love to see your utility records. Should they be able to get it? We've been working with the Public Service Department and the Public Service Department with the Public Service Board to create a regulation that says that police cannot access smart meter data held by your utility without a warrant. And if they issue a subpoena, the subpoena has to go to you, not just the utility company, so you have a right to contest it. And the other thing you can do is to not get a smart meter.
Right, and it is free. If anyone's gotten a smart meter, you can
have it swapped out.
You can have it be swapped out.
At least for now, that's what the law says.
You can still do it. But isn't it a possible conduit to get more information than just, you know, what you're using electrically? Like,
what do you mean?
I don't know.
You mean like what TV programs
spying,
you're watching?
Listening.
Oh, you mean cameras you mean and listening
know.
Devices?
Yeah, I don't know. It's kind
of... Boy, that's a new level of paranoia than even I have. I mean, probably, you know, anything's possible. If you watch Breaking Bad, you'll learn how Walter White bugged his brother-in-law, who works for the DAA, bugged his office by putting in a special cable on the computer.
I wonder what you think, whether it would work or not, and that is that the National Security Administration is some ungodly combination of the Defense Department and the intelligence community such that getting information from it is extremely difficult, and also attempting to measure in any way its effectiveness is also incredibly difficult. On the other hand, the total amount of money that it spends is not so difficult to come by. That is to say, it's part of the normal process. Do you think there's any possibility that any level of pressure coming from the Congress or from citizens in general to force them to make some kind of an assessment on an annual basis of just how successful they are? All of this money is being put to work here. Precisely how many things have they? And I understand you couldn't perhaps expect it down to the single digits, but there must be at least... My impression is that a great deal of this money is essentially bundled up and tossed into wastebaskets. There's no result to show for it except that all of us are embarrassed, unhappy, and angry that our information is being made public. Is there any way that it can become more transparent, or so that results might actually be put before us so that we could judge in some way?
I think you actually first have to do something that you think is now available, and I don't think it is, and that's their budget. I think their budget, at least most of it, is considered a black budget, and only some people in Congress know how much money is really being spent.
Wow.
So if you're looking for effectiveness versus resources invested, I don't think you can answer that question now. There is a bill that Senator Leahy is behind for putting more controls on the NSA. And I believe there is more reporting in that bill, but I can't remember. You know, what's going to happen is, unfortunately, America has a long history of responding to fear in a way where we are willing to stop asking questions and accept what we're told. It happened in World War I. It happened in World War II. It happened during McCarthy. It happened during the Red Scare generally up through the 1980s when we lost hating communists. Now we're hating people in the Middle East. We're made fearful in all kinds of ways. Whenever that fear factor comes into play, all sorts of other things happen. And democracy doesn't work well in that climate. So it's going to be a constant struggle. It really is.
Well, one of the scariest issues is that those previous incidents where we were willing to perhaps sacrifice freedom for safety, whatever that right. thing was always somehow time limited or delimited. We knew that the war would end. Obviously now our issue that is so crucial, I think, is that the war on terror, the global war on terror, has no defined end. And therefore all these things that we have, freedoms we give up and or things we are willing to fund, could go on for forever. There's no sense of the war ends and then we go back to where we were. And I think that's giving the government a great deal of freedom to do whatever it wants to do over a very long period of time.
Yeah, William Larkin, the guy who we had at our conference, the military security expert, talks about two things. One is that America is now in a continued state of war. And he also talks about the two governments that exist in this country. One is the ABC government, and that's the one we all know, and we elect our senators and representatives, and we send the IRS our taxes, and we read the Constitution and we think that's how the world operates. Then there's the XYZ government that is actually the government that is in force because the war against whoever continues. And they do things that we don't know about, and the justification is national security, and it's a never-ending power that is not evident to those of us who believe that the ABC government is what rules the country. May not be that the XYZ government is always in control, but it's always there, and it always has a pervasive influence. And I think there's something to that.
Yeah, and if you're working, talking about can't we know what they're doing. If you're working on a black project for one of the security agencies or intelligence agencies, not only the company you work for, let's say, that has a contract to do that, the people who are running that company can't be told what you're doing or how much money you're spending. Furthermore, neither can the average representative or senator.
It's true.
They simply can't, by law, cannot know what that budget is. Only four or five out of the senators that are in the security subcommittee actually know, for example, what kind of a budget the CIA has or NSA or what. No one else can know. And the rationale is always, well, it's national security, and therefore you can't know. You don't have a need to know, and we can't tell you, and we won't tell you. And
yeah.
So,
and that's this sort of the weakness of that system has been coming out because of the Snowden stuff. Because not only do those senators say we can't tell you, it's come out that some of them were not given accurate information by the NSA about what was going on. So you have these two levels.
Yeah, I mean, they could lie to the Senate.
And it would be very hard to know that that's a lie. Exactly. That's the problem. Okay, you have your...
My comment has mostly been overtaken by the discussion. But Americans, as you point out, are tend to be paranoid. And also, there's a lot of complacence. We live in a democracy. We more or less trust that our democracy is, in fact, a democracy that is open and transparent and everything that works. But we don't have to look very far to see some real abuses of that. You know, we look at things like the Enron case or something like that, or Merrill Lynch, or to go back further, J. Edgar Hoover was violating all kinds of laws and spying on people. Nixon used information that he gathered illegal for his own political purposes and everything. So we do have to address this complacency and try to put in effect more workable oversights. I don't know how we can ever get there without this.
You're never going to get to the point where you can sit back and say it's now solved. And there's the famous quotation among ACLU people that a civil liberty is never won. You have to continually re-win it. And I think that's true about all this stuff, too. You can never have a system where it's going to work perfectly and the oversight is going to be just right and we're going to know what we need to know to hold government accountable. It's a constant struggle.
Well, it doesn't say much for the government's protection of us if our contractor can just...
It is pretty ironic, isn't it?
Or
There are two things that are so ironic about the NSA. One is that Snowden, a contractor, could get away, you know, could get all this information. The other is there was a request made this summer. I read about this, I think it was ProPublica reported it, by a newspaper reporter. He made just a basic public records request of the NSA. I think it was about, it was something that really was not in any way secret. And the NSA response was, we can't respond to your inquiry because we don't know how to get the figures you want because the information resides on different databases and they're not coordinated. They can't talk to each other.
That's probably true.
And it's like, what? What? How could this possibly be happening, you know? So sometimes the best protection for privacy is incompetence. And to a large extent, I mean, in some cases, that's worked pretty well at times. But you don't know when that's worked.
As citizens, where we're in shared public space, has there yet been any court case that you know of where privacy has been invaded and it's in shared public spaces? And it's
well, in a public place, you don't have much expectation of privacy because you're in a public place. So it's generally accepted that cameras can be set up and record your being in that space, and that's not an invasion of privacy. If you want privacy, you don't go to the public space.
And what if it's being used as, like, for example, let's just invent, it's not a project, but you're not being asked permission. Is that a court case?
I don't understand that. The situation.
If people are involved in an art project, recording and not letting others know, and they're not getting a release form.
Is it in a public place?
It's in shared public space.
And then are they making a profit off of the sale of your image or whatnot? Yeah. I mean, generally, people can take pictures of you in a public place, and they have a right to take that picture. I mean, otherwise, you'd put newspapers out of business, and
you could sell your public place. I mean, what are some examples that maybe aren't so obvious to it? If I walk down the street, I can see that's a public place. Well, it's in a church on Sunday.
Well, that's definitely not a public place.
Okay.
A mall is one area that there's often disagreement about, because it's generally open to the place. It's a place of public accommodation, but it is controlled usually by a private entity, a business, and they can set rules and regulations that would be different than what the government can set in a place that's public. So it gets really complicated very quickly.
You mentioned Norwich, where the police chief actually came to the select board and asked them about the...
Yeah.
What if the select board wanted to, let's say Brattleboro didn't want the police to use this money to track license plates? Has there been any situations where, you know, the actual legal entity that controlled the city said no to the money coming from the feds and was able to block it?
Well, actually, did that happen in Bellows Falls about 3 years ago when they wanted to accept a grant of $100,000 to buy surveillance cameras?
Yes.
I think that very thing happened. They blocked it. I think the town council had a series of hearings.
So the local government would have the power to...
Yeah, I mean, I'm no expert on municipal law, but I know from being on school boards, we actually had to adopt a policy at our school that required the administration to tell us whenever they were receiving any grant funds. And it was happening because, I mean, things like, you know, your big special ed grant every year from the U.S. Department of Education is one thing. It's so obvious. You always know about it. But it's the small stuff, the $100 grant from Walmart for the teacher of the year that goes to the school. I mean, you kind of want to know about that in case there are strings attached, or because of the possible endorsement of Walmart, that acceptance of the grant might mean to people in the community. So, I mean, it would be interesting to go and look at your ordinances or ask the town manager if there is indeed a requirement that all grant monies of any size coming to the town have to be approved by the select board before the money can be spent. You know, I'll bet a lot of places, they don't have a policy, and if they do have a policy, I'll bet there are times it's not followed. That's my guess.
Okay, a couple more questions?
Yeah, we should. We've tired you out?
Oh, no.
Okay, the last two.
Yeah. I had a couple short ones. Going back to the real ID concept, thank you for clarifying that. Because the press...
Oh, it's been terrible.
Reported that you have to have it.
Let me tell you what else is really wacky. The 2017 deadline is for people who were born after 1962, I think it is. If you were born before 62, supposedly by December of this year, you've got to have the real ID.
Right.
Apparently, there's less chance of your being a terrorist if you're over the age of, what is it, 50 or something, than if you're under the age of 50. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
So we definitely won't be able to keep our...
You can keep the license you have now if you want it. And if you have a license that doesn't have a photograph on it,
I still have it. In fact, I'm the only person in Vermont that still has a paper license.
I don't know about the paper one, but you can keep the non-photo one.
If
you give it up, you're never going to get it back. Because all new licenses have to have photos.
There's a retired state cop in Colchester. I forget, he's in the legislature. Every year he tries to get a picture requirement. And I believe New Jersey was the last state.
I'm sure New Hampshire.
We're the last one left. New Hampshire, I think, requires a picture.
Really?
I'm pretty sure we're the last one.
No, like New Jersey didn't have pictures. That's
what the story is. Second sort of quick question I had, going back to the smart meters, I gave a big thank you to Senator Bob Hartwell from Bennington County,
yep,
who got that law passed that basically said, especially if they put one on your house, and they've done that in a pretty draconian way, and I've had a couple of my friends say, hey, call GMP and get that damn thing taken off your house, and they can't charge you anything for it. Do you know of any movements this year that could change that bill? Because I don't, I think the feeling was is that was sort of a stopgap temporary measure.
Yeah, if I remember, the original bill, and I don't think it was changed last year, but maybe it was, actually had a sunset on it that allowed your that allowed you to request the removal of the meter at no charge, but the provision was supposed to sunset, I don't know, at the end of 2014 or something like that. So in other words, it wasn't that it had to be changed. If nothing happened, it went out of existence.
So after 2014?
I can't remember, and it might have changed.
I'll have to go back, because
yeah, or ask Bob Hartwell. I mean, he'd probably be happy to talk about it. I see him sometimes. I can ask him, because I should know that. A couple of people have asked me that,
and
I don't know.
I wrote the GMP mouthpiece when I wrote her a long letter about this. You know, they raised the point, well, it's going to reduce costs, and they claimed that, you know, the smart meter was something about the meter reading. I said, well, wait a minute, I pay you guys like $15 a month in a service charge, and that's supposed to go for meter reading.
Well, and one of the ways they've encouraged people to have it is that you cannot get, if you do a solar energy system, you cannot get your gross credit money unless you agree to have a smart meter.
And I have an off-peak hot water meter. They were going to try to charge me $30 a month.
So it's kind of like your phone. You cannot have, if you're willing to give up the convenience of a cell phone, then you cannot be tracked. So
yeah, the other irony about the about the smart meter stuff, the state received $71 million to help build the smart meter system, the smart grid. That was Economic Recovery Act money, ERA money. So it was supposed to get people to work, right? Mm-hmm. What's the first thing that happened with smart meters?
They
put meter readers out of work.
That's right.
I thought, my gosh, what is this? You know? Oh.
That's right.
Oh, well. Did you still have a question? Or?
I was going to have an ACLU question. Maybe I'll just defer it till we're...
Okay. Speaking of ACLU, I do have some copies of our report up here. There's also a short... We call it a focus piece that sort of puts all the main points of the surveillance report on two sides. And then we also have Bill of Rights bookmarks. You're welcome to take one of these. And there's also a general brochure about us, including information about membership if you're so inclined. So thanks for coming.